J. Arun Daniel, sir, associate professor from the Department of Community Medicine, to present his topics on the experimental study design, including the randomized control. Sir, the stage is yours.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
A very good afternoon. Hope I'm audible.
You're audible, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon to one and all. I'm happy to share stage with any experienced people. Dr. Nishad, I was very happy to listen to sir because sir was my teacher and he gave a very beautiful and wonderful lecture. I was very moved and went to my olden days where he used to explain so many things to us in our UG days. And so my task today is to explain something about experimental study design. So I think we have had a run through towards cross-sectional study designs and case control and cohort, which are analytical studies. Now we are entering into the crux of the experiments, namely the experimental study design. Okay. So as we know already that choosing the study design seems to be a very vital part in any research. And if we have chosen the study design in a right way, everything will go towards success. And I think we have an exclusive session on how to choose a study design tomorrow by Dean HP Madam, I suppose. And so today we are going to just elaborate on what are the important things in each of the study designs. So I would like to outline my presentation, giving a clarity about how the hierarchy of RCTs are placed in the choosing of a study designs, and just going to minimally give some introduction about the process of how to do an RCT, and some points to touch upon the types of randomized controlled trials and experimental studies, a small brief introduction to the analysis and representation of data in RCTs. And as we all know that study design is very, very vital part. Yesterday we started our research methodology workshop with the research question. So usually when we guide and the student, PG student, they sit together, they decide, and suddenly they get a wonderful idea about the research question. And they speculate a lot on it. They talk a lot to each other about the research question. You know, yesterday sir has mentioned about the finer criteria, how to choose the research question. I hope the recap also has helped today to redefine these things. So after choosing the research question or the research idea, then there'll be exclusive search of literature. There'll be lots of literature search going on. The guide and student will be sitting together and working on lots of literature, reviewing lots of articles. And the problem comes when there has to be, they have to choose a proper study design and calculate a sample size. That's when they refer them to the other department, especially to the community medicine department, and where we help them to calculate the sample size. But I wonder that the study design has to be the ownership of the investigator. The study design calculated well, or the study design which has been talked about in the discussions, will help them in long way in calculating sample size and all the other processes thereon leading to. Research is all about these two things. One is the population and the sample. Of course, as sir has mentioned earlier, we cannot study the entire population, which is not feasible. We have to take a sample. We have to take a sample from the population by a method called as sampling. How we do that sampling and how we collect the sample from the population is depending upon a lots of research techniques, which is also covered in the days to come in sampling and other sessions. Now, when we collect when we obtain some sample from the population and do a study in that sample, then we collect what all informations which have been inferences which have been made on the sample, we referred it or extrapolated back to the population. This is what research is all about. We always take a population where we want to study the condition, and then we take a sample out of it, we make inferences in the sample, and then we revert it back to the population. How we make the inference is based on a lot of statistical techniques to make the sample and the population look almost similar to each other. Not only statistics, what study design we choose makes it more important how we can make the sample representative of the population. Now, there are lots of study designs. We have almost covered many things in this, including the observational, cross-sectional, and case control and cohort studies. And we have the experimental study designs. Now, which study design to choose will be a big debate when we enter into the review of literature and find lots of studies which are done in different ways. The first case of COVID was reported as a case report in Bhutan. And it was not that much fantasied by any of the people. Almost people don't know even that a case report has come, because it was only one case which was reported as a case. Later, in New York, there were three febrile infants who were stuck with coronavirus, which was reported as a case series. And that gave some alarm to the world. But the true crux of the problem came out when there was a cross-sectional study which was done among 28,503 randomly selected adult patients involving COVID. Why I am putting this progression is the hierarchy in which the study designs are placed. The evidence, the quality of evidence which is obtainable from each of the study design varies. For example, we are here at the experimental study designs, where we are going to talk about randomized and non-randomized controlled trials. The quality of evidence and the acceptance of these studies in publications are different compared to the analytical and observational types of studies. That's what I would like to try to emphasize here. We know that there is something called as hypothesis generating and hypothesis testing studies. Yesterday also somebody asked in the chat box, do we have to write the hypothesis for all the studies? No, there are studies where we generate hypothesis, like a cross-sectional study or a observational study, where we generate the hypothesis. And in some studies like experimental studies or analytical studies, we test that hypothesis. Only in those studies where we test the hypothesis and we have already an hypothesis in hand, we are going to write the hypothesis. So here, Newton observed the apple falling from a tree. There may be some person sitting on the top of the tree also pushing the apple down. So unless he takes that apple and drops it himself and see that there is a gravitational force pulling it, then he cannot believe that particular observation. So any observational studies are being completed only by confirming it with an experiment. That is the importance of an experimental study design. Now, I think we all know this story, which is the first chapter of the Holy Bible, which states about Adam and Eve, the first human beings created by God. And you know that Adam and Eve were told by God that you should not eat a particular fruit from a particular tree, and that was forbidden tree. But you know that Satan came and spoke in the mind of Eve and asked her to pluck one free fruit and eat it. And they both had the fruit and they faced the consequence and they were punished by God. So that is a famous story. Now, if you want to see the story in a different angle, now this guy looks to me like a principal investigator. And he is doing an intervention by giving this fruit, which is the intervention or the manipulation, to the study groups, namely the human beings. And he doesn't do that to the other organisms, which serve as a control group. And then he follows up what happens later. And we all know what is the effect or result of the study. And that amounts to be the world's first human experiment in a nutshell. So I'm trying to explain the steps of a randomized control trial or a experimental study design in a much understandable or palatable way. we always need an investigator. There should be an intervention. There should be a study and a control group to find out the difference in the effect. There should be a follow-up and analysis. Right. Now, we all know who this person is. There was a British sailor who took 12 British sailors along with him in a cruise. In between, they all started becoming weak and getting anemic. They started bleeding from their gums. Now, what this person, James Lind, did is he divided them into 6 groups. He gave them different types of interventions, including cider, vitriol, seawater, and orange or lime juice and spicy paste. And to his surprise, group 5, which was the limeys group, they had a better response to the therapy and they all passed away. And with that result, he saved the other people's also. So this was a famous experiment or human experiment, which was done during 1747 by James Lind, which is the famous scurvy experiment. Later, animals were used for testing the drugs or any interventions. They used animals to test the drugs or the injections which are given to the animals. But soon this became little cruel. Soon this became cruel, where animals were being tortured and there was no boundaries for these animal experiments. For example, this was a very threatening Demico's multi-dog experiment, where they tried to fuse the heads of dogs and try to find out if they can create multi-dogs. So these kind of cruel experiments were conducted on animals, and the animals became sad. During the Nazis' time, there was a still more cruel experiments which were conducted by conducting those experiments in the children, by putting them into a gas chamber and then following them up if they develop any deformities. And these type of cruel experiments were paved way to development of the famous code of ethics. Now I'm not going to touch more upon code of ethics and ethics, because our Guruji sir, Vishnu Bhatt sir, is going to have an elaborate session on ethics in research. So we just have to know that any experiment in the world has to follow some code of ethics, and WHO has laid its strict code of practice in connection with human trials in 1980. So how we select patients for an RCT? They must always give an informed consent, that is, applies to any study, not only the RCTs. A participant information sheet is very important aspect of a randomized control trial. We need to write all the important things. And you know, in our IRC meetings, our sir, director of research, he stresses upon how to write the participant information sheet and how to write about the compensations, how to write about the ethical issues. And so this forms the most important part of the selection of candidates. Once you have informed them clearly what is going to be the experiment doing on them, then we can inform them and get them into our study, recruit them into the study. They should be representative of the population. This is also an important criteria. You cannot select population from different areas where you are not doing or going to extrapolate the study results. They should be eligible for the study. They should have the disease which you are going to study, first of all, and they should be eligible to enter into the study. So these are the important selection criteria when you choose people for your study in a broad basis. Government of India also lays down guidelines to register every trial. In Clinical Trial Registry of India, we have to just go to this website called as ctri.nic.in. We have to create an user ID and password, where it asks for a detailed explanation about your study design, your sample size, what is the protocol you're going to follow, how many participants you're going to recruit, and what statistical tests you're going to use, what is the ethical considerations in your study. Everything you have to clearly lay down in a format or a pro forma. And then they will give you a temporary registration number, after which we can approve this study in the Human Ethics Committee also. And then we can get a permanent registration number. As you can see that I have registered this trial in 2018 and I've got this CTRI permanent registration number. And every 6 months you are expected to update what progress and what follow-up details you have got into the studies to CTRA. So this is one mechanism where you can be more safe. If there is any legal problem concerning to your trial or experiment, then this CTRA registration can be a lifesaver. At the same time, now I have registered this trial in 2018. After this, if somebody has done a similar study, then I can claim the rights for the study. This is one way of making sure that it's your own study. So CTRA registration, I feel, is a very mandatory thing to do in any type of clinical trial. Now, coming to the types of experiments, we have the randomized control trials and non-randomized control trials. We'll see about it in detail. I've already explained the steps of the RCT in our Adam and Eve story. We need to go more scientific by drawing up a clear protocol before starting any RCT. The protocol will be the main part of any RCT. Any deviations from the protocol will not be allowed once you fix and submit the protocol to the research committee. You have to select the reference or control population and the experimental population. This should be selected based on randomization. Randomization is a technique where you will ensure that the control group and experimental group had equal chances to select its participants. Then you do the manipulation or intervention or the real intervention you will do, and then you will follow up what are the changes happening, and then finally you will assess the outcome of the RCT after applying the intervention. So these are the major steps in the RCT. Now, if we take the protocol, you know, the protocol is the essential part of any RCT. It should be followed like a Bhagavad Gita. Going to include only these many participants. I'm going to do it for this much time. You should not deviate from the protocol. The moment you deviate from the protocol, then you are doing a bias in your randomized control trial. So protocol, when it is written, it should be written with complete knowledge about the end of the study. What you are going to hypothesize and what you are going to emphasize in your study or what you are going to extrapolate, everything has to be clear in your mind before writing the protocol, because protocol forms the important step in preventing bias or errors in your study. What all should go inside a protocol? The aims and objectives of the study. As you know, that yesterday there was a session on how to write aims and objectives, and what all research question you are going to answer in the study, and what criteria for selection of cases, what is the criteria for selection of control group. As Dr. Nishad that put right forth how to select the control, same things also apply here. They should be almost similar to the study group, unless the variable which is under study. Other than that, they should be almost similar to the study group. The size of the sample size calculation is a very important part, and it should be submitted in the protocol. Any deviations or reductions in the sample size have to be intimated to the research committee well in advance, especially in clinical trials. Then procedure for allocation of subjects into study and control groups, that is the randomization details, have to be very clearly put forth. How the randomization is going to be done, what type of randomization is going to be done, how the participants will be allocated if they are going to lost to follow up. If the participants are lost from the study, what you are going to do to analyze the data. All these things have to be put forth in the protocol very clearly. Now, since we don't have a workshop session or a hands-on session in this workshop, I'm just going to show you a worked up example. A simple one. My research question is, will intimation to parents about students' attendance will reduce bunking classes among students? So it's a simple research question. So my hypothesis is, if students' parents are being intimated, the bunking rate will reduce among the intimated students compared to the non-intimated students, let's say. So I select those students only who bunk more than 50% of the classes. So this is the eligibility criteria. So for before dividing the participants into control group and the intervention group, the eligibility criteria has to be fixed who are going to be included in your studies. So the students who bunk more than 50% of the classes only I'm including in the study. Those persons who are perfect, I'm not going to make any change by sending their marks or attendance to the parents. So my eligibility criteria is fixed as 50%. I'm going to select my sample size. I calculated the sample size by using some formula, which is needed for the sample size calculation for RCTs. And then I calculated the sample size as 50. Let's keep. I'm going to divide this into 25 experimental group and 25 into the control group. I'm going to apply a manipulation. I randomized the students into control group and experimental group. I'll tell you how I did that. The manipulation or the intervention which I'm going to do is inform the parents every month regarding their attendance. And the outcome which I'm going to see is whether the students have improved in their attendance and whether there is any difference between the attendance improvement in the intimated groups and the non-intimated groups. So that is the outcome which I'm going to see. I hope you are following this example. Now, randomization is the heart of a RCT. And when you do randomization in a perfect way, as Dr. Nishad has told very clearly, randomization is one way where you can avoid all the selection biases. We cannot say that just because that person was allocated into that group, he has got that result when you do randomization. So randomization is the best way to prevent any bias in an RCT. Now, how do we do this randomized bias in our study? I'm going to select students here in our community medicine, and I'm going to take their attendance percentage. I'm going to feed it into the department computer, and the clerk will send randomly to 25 students their attendance, and to other 25 students they are not going to send. So randomly they have been allocated into the control group and intervention group. So I am not even involved in this. The clerk is doing it. I'll tell you why. Why I did that is to do this concept called as blinding. Blinding is an important concept to prevent prejudice in your study. We cannot be prejudgmental about the results what you will get. If I say, I know very well that if I send the attendance to the students will improve. I should not be in that justice before itself. I should not be in the judgment before itself. So I do something called as blinding. So there are three types of blinding, that include single blinding, double blinding, and triple blinding. I'll explain what is that with that example. Now, here you can see the students are the participants in the study, and I am the investigator, and the clerk is the analyzer. Okay. Now, if the participants do not know which group they are going into, whether the control group or the intervention group, that is called single blinding. If I do not know, the investigator doesn't know which group the students are going to be allotted into, that is called double blinding. And if the person who is going to do the analysis or the clerk doesn't know, if, for example, I generate a random number sequence in the computer itself, a software which will automatically allocate the students into two different groups without the clerk knowing, then that is called triple blinding. Triple blinding is usually not needed, and it is only needed in very, very high class drug trials, whereas double blinded studies are more than sufficient for our randomized control trials in medical field. Then I do the manipulation. I send the monthly attendance report to all at home, and I have intervention I have applied. And next thing is I'm going to follow up these people. And in the protocol itself, I mentioned how frequently I'm going to follow up. What are the parameters I'm going to follow up? Everything is written in the protocol. As per protocol, I'm going to follow up every month. What is their improvement in attendance? And what is the bunking rate among the students? And I find whether there is improvement or not. I'm going to do the last step called as assessment or analysis, where I'm going to find out whether there is an improvement in the control group or in the experimental group where I've sent the report. So I found out that 20 among the 25 students who I intimated developed their attendance good in the next 4 months. Whereas in the non-intimated group, they still remained the same. So 20 minus 4, 16 is my improvement or the difference. Whether this difference between the control group and the experimental group is significant or not, I will test using a test of significance or statistical test, which is going to be dealt by the JIPMER team soon. So in this analysis, I'll find out which group is important, which group has achieved its knowledge, and which group has improved. That is what I do in an assessment. Hope I'm clear till this phase. This completes the process of RCT. Now I'm going to talk about some types of RCTs, which is little more complicated than what we saw earlier. Now, this is one type of study design called concurrent parallel study design, where we are dividing the study population into two groups. We are randomizing into two groups, A and B. One group is given drug A, one group is given drug B. And we are seeing the outcome of people who receive the drug A, outcome of people who receive drug B. That's it. We'll compare the outcomes. This is a concurrent parallel trial. Next type of trial is called as a crossover trial, where I give random allocation into A group and B group, and I follow these people for outcomes. Then I cross them over. Those who receive treatment A will now receive treatment B, and those who receive treatment B will receive treatment A. I cross over them and then find out what is the outcome of crossover. Now, for example, telmisartan and amlodipine, two drugs we are comparing. Treatment A is telmisartan and treatment B is amlodipine. After I give telmisartan, I follow up the BP reduction for almost 3 months. Then I stop the drug, that is called washout period, where the drug's efficacy from the body is totally washed off. Then I cross them over like this. Those received telmisartan will be now taking amlodipine. Those taking amlodipine will now take telmisartan. And then I follow them up to find out the BP reduction. Now I have two data here. One is BP reduction of one set of people by taking telmisartan. The same set of people also have taken amlodipine later, and the BP reduction also I have in hand. Now this makes those group as the self controls for themselves. Hope you understood. The treatment group, which was earlier taking the drug, now stopped that drug and taken another drug. So those same people, same biological group, has taken the different drug and they became controls for that previous intervention. So this is the beautiful part of crossover RCTs, but it is sometimes suffering lots from ethical issues. You cannot do a crossover as and when you like, because if you find that one drug is totally going to be showing adverse effects, it is difficult or it is not ethical to cross them over to the drug, to a bad drug which is not performed well. So this is the problem or ethical problem in this crossover RCTs. Now, other types of randomized controls include clinical trials, preventive trials. You know, vaccine trials are going on now in the country. Vaccine trials, you give the vaccine and find out how much disease is being prevented. That is the outcome. Risk factor trials, where you intervene for one risk factor. For example, you are studying cardiovascular risk factor. You can treat cholesterol and find out if the outcome, namely the cardiovascular diseases, has changed or not. That is what they did in Framingham Heart Study. And then the cessation experiments. You stop the lung cancer, you stop the smoking and find out whether they develop lung cancer or not. This is called cessation experiments. We have etiological agents. This is the Nazi experiments, where they induced the disease by inducing an etiological factor. They created an etiological factor in a person and found out whether the disease developed or not. This is highly unethical studies, never being permitted at this juncture in this centuries. And evaluation of health studies. For example, you are introducing a newer technique like DOTS or DOTS Plus. How that regimen or how that intervention has made a change in the program or health related changes which has happened because of the intervention. So those are called as evaluation of health study RCTs. Now, other types of experiments include before and after trial. Here, for example, we are going to do a health education session. Before doing health education session, you found out the contraceptive usage. And after your health education session about family planning, you again analyze and find out what is the contraceptive usage, whether it has improved or not based on your intervention called health education. So this is called as a before and after trial. Here we don't have control group at all. The same group has been used as a control before and after. The next type of studies include non-randomized control. Here we do not do randomization at all, but sometimes due to feasibility issues or due to ethical issues, we will not be able to randomize at all. For example, we are going to find out the efficacy of a surgery over a medical intervention. There we cannot choose who will go into surgery and who will go into medical intervention randomly and all. That is highly unethical. So there we will do a non-randomized control trial, though the efficacy or power of the study will be lower compared to a randomized trial and the bias will be more. These kind of studies can pave way to more data regarding how to do a randomized control trial. next step. So this can be used as a preliminary step before doing an actual RCT, right? Now, lots of speculations are going on in the media and about the trials. We know that there are 4 phases in any drug trial, and I'm not going to talk about drug trials. We have a separate session for that. And the phase 3 trials is where we do the RCT, where we compare the safety and efficacy of a drug with an existing drug. We compare this drug with an existing drug or this vaccine with how it has prevented the disease or not. And the follow-up period in such kind of clinical trials extends till the post-market surveillance time. It's a wrong misconception that phase 3 trials are over within, the follow-up gets over within the phase 3. No. The phase 3, the RCT follow-up of the clinical trials always extends till phase 4, till the post-market surveillance results are available. Now, based on hypothesis, we can divide the randomized control trials into superiority trials, equivalence trials, and non-inferiority trials. Very simple. If you want to prove that drug A is superior to drug B, if that is your hypothesis, then you are doing a superiority trial. If you are going to prove that drug A is almost equal in efficacy to the drug B, then it's an equivalence trial. This we use in diagnostic procedures. For example, this machine, the diagnostic machine, is as equal to CT in detecting cancer. If you want to prove that, that is called equivalence. That is called equivalence trial. Non-inferiority trials is we want to prove that gold standard is there. This is nowhere inferior to that. If you want to prove that, then we use non-inferiority clinical trials. Now, I'm going to touch upon a little bit about analysis of an RCT, but it's not going to be a very elaborate session on this because I'm going to just touch upon how to do an analysis in an RCT, the process. There are 3 types of ways where you can approach an analysis for RCTs. One is intention to treat analysis. Number 2 is per protocol analysis. Number 3 is as treated analysis. First one, intention to treat analysis is we randomize the subjects into treatment A and treatment B. They receive drug A or drug B. Whether they complete the treatment or not, whether they have stopped the treatment or not, the randomization will be maintained till the analysis is over. Here, loss to follow-up will not be taken into account. They will be analyzed based on the group which they are allotted. There is no scope for loss of follow-up. So whenever you are going to test some diet, for example, whether the non-vegetarian diet is better than a vegetarian diet, these kind of intention to treat analysis are used because if you are telling a diabetic patient you are not going to eat sweets from tomorrow, maybe they will say, okay, sir, but in real life scenario, there may be some function where they'll eat that sweet. So strict adherence to diet as an intervention will not be possible. In that case, the real life scenarios can be mimicked by using this kind of intention to treat analysis, where you can include those people who have deviated from the protocol also into the analysis. The next type of analysis is per protocol analysis, where treatment A and treatment B is randomly allocated. These groups are allocated. Those people who have completed the treatment in treatment A are compared with those people who have completed the treatment as per protocol in the treatment B. Those people who have not complied to the treatment in both the groups are eliminated from the analysis. So this is called as per protocol analysis. We follow the strict protocol. We will not include people who have deviated from the protocol. So what's the problem with these kind of studies is there will be a lot of dropouts. For example, if treatment B is very difficult to follow, there will be lots of people who have dropped out from the treatment B, and treatment A, there will be more sample size. So if you are going to compare 20 people with 100 people in treatment A, then that comparison or analysis will not be that great. But if you maintain a proper discipline in preventing loss to follow-up in these kind of studies, per protocol analysis is a perfect analysis. And per protocol analysis is that analysis which you have to send to publications when we are going to submit articles for a highly reputed journal. Intention to treat analysis will not be accepted mostly in many reputed journals. As treated analysis is a different hybrid of both these things which I have told. Those people, sometimes they feel treatment A is better than treatment B, so they'll switch from treatment B to treatment A, switching groups. In that case, those people who have treated as treatment B will be taken as treatment B only, whether they are in the control group or intervention group. doesn't matter, the randomization is broken here and they are not no more bothered about randomization, but they are treated as per what drug they have taken. This is also another type of analysis. This is also acceptable by many journals. But what happens is the real effect of the treatment can be really measured in these studies, in this type of analysis. Even though the randomization is lost, the real effect of the treatment, because the person has taken only that treatment and he has not deviated from that particular treatment. So that is the liberty of this as per treated analysis. The last part of my presentation is about how to represent the data of a trial, randomized controlled trial. For example, you have tested a drug A with drug B. How will you say that it's more effective than the other drug? Is by a term called as number needed to treat. Number needed to treat is the pattern, is the number of patients you need to treat to prevent one additional bad outcome or death. For example, if drug A has a number needed to treat of 25, it means you have to treat 25 people to prevent one additional bad outcome. It is almost the inverse of absolute risk reduction. Now let's see with an example. There are some people who are vaccinated, 100 people who are vaccinated, 100 people who are not vaccinated. We have randomized them and we are going to find out how many deaths have been introduced in these two groups. Yeah, we have studied by a follow-up study. We find that 30 people died in the not vaccinated group and 5 people have died in the vaccinated group. So we are going to calculate the absolute risk reduction by measuring incidence among the control group, deaths, incidence of deaths among the control group, minus incidence of death among the treated or vaccinated group. We'll get 25% as the answer. That is the absolute risk reduction. Now, if you take the inverse of it, 4, you'll get it as 4. That is the number needed to treat. So you have to vaccinate 4 people to prevent one death from happening. So this is how you tell for a drug also. If you feel that a drug is having an NNT of around 5, that means the drug is highly effective in preventing the adverse events. The NNT of aspirin is around 45. That means you have to treat 45 people with aspirin to prevent one death. So that is the way of representing your result of a RCT. I hope this point was clear. I usually read a lot about birds and I like this bird called penguin. This bird flies. I heard that this bird flies long distances, but it is more prevalent in these Arctic regions and very snow-bound areas. So it couldn't find its prey in the space. It couldn't find its prey in the outside environment. So it adapted itself to swim. So it reduced its wings. It made itself into fins and started swimming. And it can drink seawater. It adapted lots. And it started feeding on the fishes and aquatic animals. It started feeding on the aquatic organisms and started surviving. And that's a very peculiar thing, that a person, a bird which was flying, converting itself into an aquatic organism. But later it found that there are lots of predators in the sea, like whales, which were life-threatening to it. So it started coming to the land. It started coming to the land and became human-friendly. Okay, it started liking humans so much that it started mimicking them and started walking upright also. So I find this very amusing, that a bird which was flying became a swimmer and then it started walking also. So this, all these things happen because of need. All these things happen because of demand. That's why it's walking upright now. Similarly, at one point of time, we were expected to just put biometry and go and see the cases in the wards and take classes. But now we are expected to be researchers. And the scope of research and expectation about a researcher has also changed over time. We were able to publish in some conferences or some any journal. Now it has become, you have to publish in journals which are indexed in Index Copernicus. Then it became, we have to publish in Scopus Index and PubMed indexed and Web of Science indexed journals. Then it became indexed as well as a high impact factor journal. Now, I think promotions will be based on H-Index and I-10 Index and Google Scholar citation scores. And soon we might also be asked to publish in Lancet. So the time changes and expectation changes. And if at all you want a quality publication, if at all you want to put yourself into a high reputed journals, then you have to remember this triangle where the hierarchy of study design matters. The more you go into hierarchy, like you don't have to do a meta-analysis or systematic reviews, but at least randomized controlled trials or experimental study designs or cohort studies, you increase your hierarchy more and more, the more chances that you get published in a reputed journal. And that's what I would like to say, that you have to adopt or metamorphose yourself into choosing higher study designs, and designing the study without any bias is the crux of the story. And doing it with ethics, doing it with lots of ethics, is also very important. I'm sure that Vishnu sir is going to talk a lot about ethics, but ethics in RCT is the most important part, even compared to the trial itself. And all my friends, get vaccinated and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
There is one question which Vishnubhat sir has asked. He has sent it to me. Is random selection and randomization of participants, is there a difference?
Sir, randomization is allocating the subjects into control group and the intervention group. So there are lots of types of randomization, including block randomization, how you allocate the subjects into different groups. But random selection is even before the randomization, how you select subjects into your study itself. So after selection of the studies randomly into your study only, the randomization will be done, sir. I hope I have answered, sir.
Yes, randomization, only thing I found with your example of clerk sending information about students' performance to parents, no? Like when you say you are randomizing, that means that the person is has an equal chance to get into either limb of the study. He yes. can either go to get his marks informed to the parents, or he need not have his marks informed to the parents. There is an equal chance. So if there is a bias which is brought in there, no, if it is going to be, let's say, the first 50 will get informed this month, and the second 50 goes next month. I'm just giving an example. If there is a predictable pattern, then it doesn't become randomization. That is the only thing I wanted to add to that very nice presentation.
Thank you, ma'am. And number needed to harm, as somebody has asked me in the chat box, number needed to harm is what I told about absolute risk reduction. So how many people, if you don't treat with that particular drug, will you harm that patient? So exactly the reverse of number needed to treat.
Is OR and absolute risk reduction same, or is it different?
No, madam, no. Both are different, because here we are going to use it for a risk reduction, whereas OR is used for risk estimation.
Okay. Can you give one example, please?
For example, smoking and lung cancer, the odds ratio of 2 means those who smoke have 2 times higher risk of getting the lung cancer. So that measures the strength of association. Whereas relative risk, what you asked, the other one is relative risk. Yeah.
Absolute risk reduction.
Absolute risk reduction is when you give that particular intervention, how much risk will be reduced? That is the thing which you get out of absolute risk reduction. It is an hybrid of actually relative risk, which we use in that cohort studies. It's actually a hybrid which you use in the experimental studies, but it is not OR. OR is measuring the strength of association, whereas RR, or the absolute risk reduction, is the risk reduction related to the intervention.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
There is a message in chat box from Dr. Satyamurthy. All the presentations today had been very informative. And the nursing principal says that excellent presentation. Thank you for your effort in simplifying the topic. Oh, Vishnubhat sir wants to be unmuted. 1 minute, sir. Sir, you can unmute yourself now. There was some disturbance, so we had to put that off mic.
This point I raised because many people write randomized study, but actually they randomized the sample. So randomization allotment is different from random selection. Random selection is in order to avoid the bias, which he has already clearly mentioned. So the doubt has been cleared. I just put it because while writing, you should be clear what you are writing. So we use the random number for selections, so the bias will be avoided. But in a RCT, it is a randomization. In the sense, you use the random number and putting in one side or other side without bias. Anyhow, thank you. I think we can go for the next speaker, because I think already it is 4:04. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Can I say anything, sir? What I sir? Think randomization is from existing population you are selecting, but maybe you are taking all participants in that case. But when you do that random selection, from selecting some people, it is something like that. That's what I understand.
No. I just wanted to tell the difference between what is random selection and randomization. I think that point he has already clarified. So selection bias we have to avoid. That's why we use the random selection. But after selection, when you have randomized in a RCT, you have to put them in either side so that the bias will be removed among the selected population.
That is randomization, sir. What I mean to say, random selection means from whole population you are selecting randomly from all areas. That is random selection. Randomization.
Yes, you are right. I think we'll go to the next speaker.
Chance to all people who are selected.
That's exactly what I'm trying to tell. One is random selection. Another is randomization in the RCT. They are two different things. We should not get confused. Shall we go to the next speaker?